Hello, Zero K fans, and welcome to Nanolays at Dawn. I'm your host, ChetaFury333, with a bit of a surprise cast today, alongside GoogleFrog, as we're going to show off what the AI can do nowadays.
Hi. So we should start now?
Yeah. So, 3, 2, 1, go! Alright, so we have, over to the north side, we have JohnHunter, Manero, Hectorion, Shaman, Alcur, and Edrush, all fighting against a team of CircuitAI. GoogleFrog, you really wanted to go into detail about the AI.
Well, I didn't write the AI. It's written by Lamer. This, I think, is Ivory King's configuration of it. And this is one of the AIs. They all don't cheat, which they've been writing for, I don't know how many years now. A few years at least, for some of them.
So, for those of you not familiar, Zero K is quite the complex game. Writing an AI for this game, especially without cheating, requires a lot of adjusting to circumstances, a lot of understanding strategies. Now, CircuitAI, is that an AI that is more adaptive, or is it just one that is built around set strategies and tries to execute those?
I think there is some adaptivity. Like, I've watched this game, and it does seem to adapt at points. I think this one's particularly good at moving around and avoiding fights, which it shouldn't take.
Ah, yeah, that seems pretty important. Whereas, of course, our human players are relatively wide range of human players, all around the 1600 to 1800 elo range for team play. So they're quite used to these large 6v6 or larger team games. So imagine for them, it's this is kind of typical, but the AI is already expanding quite a lot, a bit more than the human players, in fact. Being very aggressive on that expansion and on reclaim, just generally their economy is going nuts.
Yeah, they maintain the economy really well. They've, like on the right, you can see a circuit's got some metal extractors already halfway up the map.
Yeah, and that
the human players are a bit slower.
Yeah, that degree of expansion, and the thing is that I believe that is one of the big things CircuitAI does, as opposed to say KGB AI, or Zero K graph-based AI, which is, I believe, more of an adaptive micro-oriented AI, if I'm not mistaken, but I might be mistaken on that one.
Although, to the players' credits, they are probably not expecting a particularly difficult battle, you know, given RTS AIs.
Well, that's true, especially given that CAI, which was the de facto AI for Zero K for years, had roughly 1400 elo. Like, it was rated roughly at that level.
Yeah, that one's pretty bad. I wrote that one 6 years ago now. And have left it to the community, basically, to write better ones.
Which they have. I mean, took a little while, but yeah, they managed to. And, oh, sorry, this is 7v7, but yeah, it's, so that's the thing, is this is definitely a game that is going to be, I imagine, a bit trickier than they expect. At this point, it is relatively even, though, in the north side, with roughly the same economy as the south side. So the AI ahead by 10, but it's not a big deal. The problem I do see is position. I'm curious, are we seeing, the north side isn't really focusing as much as I would expect on any one point. Neither are the AI. I don't know how much the AI is designed around team coordination, but the human players,
I think this
defense
isn't one which is great for team coordination. There's some which are really focused on team play. This one can 1v1.
So there's that advantage for the human players to some extent, even though it doesn't seem to be taken advantage of right now. At this point, one of the AI is coming over, trying to take out as best they can Alcur's side of the base, or Alcur's defenses. And Alcur themselves, not really focused as much. They're a bit more in the front. They're definitely more economically focused. I don't think they have a whole lot to their name other than their economy, really.
Note that that's an Alcur Shaman comm share, taking up the entire right side of the map.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah, that's another thing I should probably point out, is there is another feature called comm share. It's a bit experimental, but basically, it's a thing that has always been in Spring, that players could be essentially controlling the same units, and multiple players, but one set of units. That's something which actually hadn't had a proper interface for Zero K for years, and basically, Shaman actually implemented that recently. It's still a bit experimental, there's still a little bit of kinks to work out, but it's neat. And yeah, that's what
especially social kinks.
Yeah, the social gigs are a bit
really
hard
to
big one.
Do.
Yeah.
What's so there's an AI in the middle. Seems to want to... Oh no, it's moving back.
Yeah, it's being a bit cautious. The AI at this point... I think if they... Oh, actually, the western side. I was about to say, one crucial battle could actually be a problem for them. And at this point, one of the AIs over to the western side getting pushed back by JohnHunter. Although, admittedly, the Faraday now stopping JohnHunter from doing a whole lot of good. But still, getting pushed back some of this Reaper, causing problems. As long as the Outlaw does not die, it should be okay. But the Outlaw's basically one shot from death. That's the one thing, though.
They've got a lot of shields.
Yeah, they're... but not enough, unfortunately. That was a lightning gun. Lightning guns do pierce shields extremely well. So that did not last long. However, like I said, if they get
that's
one...
That's JohnHunter's Faraday.
Yeah. But I'm just thinking if, on the western side, JohnHunter managed to get enough there, really punch through that side, get a little bit of an advantage economically, I think that would give the north side something of an advantage. The AI is being a little bit skittish. And we are seeing the human players creep up slowly but surely. At this point, looks like the AI over to the eastern side with the Reapers. Actually, a few Reapers on the AI side. They seem to just have a few of them just for trying to get through a little bit of the defenses, siege things up a little bit, not really do much with it, though. They're not going for the, like, five Reaper strategy where you just punch through with the Strider's cost worth of Reapers. Which...
Well, it is retreating into Reaper, and that's the important thing of Reaper usage.
I meant over to the western side. The eastern side, yeah. Oh, sorry, the eastern side. The western side, yes, they are retreating a fair bit. Or they were. They're coming back in, but the eastern side is just plowing through. And there isn't a whole lot defending it either. So no surprises there. I guess it's scattered out well enough.
The players might be still messing around at this point. This large fortress in the middle is a decent idea, but perhaps a bit too static.
Not sure where the money is going. That's the thing, is at this point... Oh, my apologies, everybody. I don't know if this is going to be much good, but I actually wasn't showing all the construction going on here. Yeah, at this point, it looks like the Alcur Shaman Comshare is doing the majority of the... No, sorry. It's actually pretty spread out. Everyone's doing some construction. It looks like most of the offensive construction is over to Hectorion, handling a lot of the spiders. While, on the other hand, Manero going for a bit of the... Well, going for some Rockos. JohnHunter going for just extra shield, trying to push forward into the western side. Edrush with the airstrikes coming in later on. Actually helping a little bit now, too. This point... Wow. Glaive's coming in the back row for CAI. And I don't know if this panel is actually being too... Is this not very performant? No, it's not, actually. It's very slow. Anyway, at this point, Glaive's coming and doing quite a lot of damage over to the northern side, over to Hectorion's base and to, looks like, Monero's base. Both of them taking a huge chunk of damage from this, particularly to their energy production. Although at this point, the north side, pretty okay with energy production, has a few storages out just to make sure, I guess in case their commanders die, or just in general to have storage, but definitely if their commanders die, that is a thing now. For those of you who haven't played in a while, commanders now have storage. That starting 500 storage is no longer off-map stuff. And it looks like CircuitAI getting a little bit confused about wreckages. Over to the south as well, we have El Monero, able to hold off a little bit of an assault. Reaper coming in here from one of the AIs. Not too large of a force, actually. Should be relatively easy to hold off, especially once it gets stunned out. Overall, though, that Reaper needs to retreat. I don't think it's actually going to be able to successfully do so. The amount of damage it's taking is substantial. A few good shots. One more Stinger shot, but I don't think... Yeah, it won't be in range. That's just slightly out of range.
Yeah, it's quite good at using Reapers and repairing them to get a force. If you look at the attrition, the AI has actually lost fewer metal in units, although more units overall. Must be using cheaper units.
No, I can't tell. I didn't have the attrition counter on before. But anyway, that was my mistake, or the attrition counter not actually counting up when it's not on, which is not its fault. But anyway, the same time JohnHunter is holding down, so yeah, the AI, if they're a little bit less efficient, that would be a problem. The human players have really started to fight back. They do have a decent position to work from. The AI, with an economic advantage, as they have had for most of this game, the human players have been able to go with reclaim, but not... otherwise actually had the advantage. But it looks like they're taking some metal extractors. So that's going to be a thing. They're going to actually be able to possibly turn this around, swing the economy back in their favor, and then from there, maybe take the game. As long as they have the economy, they have a position to work from.
Yeah, AIs tend to lose when they have equal or less economy.
Well,
they just require a numbers game.
Yeah, it depends on the AI though, because I'm pretty sure I was hearing that KGB AI, or ZKGB AI, was actually really good at dealing with just tactical situations. It was really good at micromanagement and knowing where to place units and how to position them. And that was more of its strength. But I could be mistaken. I haven't really played much AI matches myself. I tend to prefer other human beings, which I suppose is a little bit prejudiced of me. I'm just a horrible organicist. I confess to that.
Not giving the AIs a chance to shine.
Not personally, no. I am kind of now. I believe this is making up for my previous sins.
A little bit.
Well, got to start somewhere. Anyway, a few Wyverns coming in.
Look
here,
at the middle.
Which, yeah.
AIs build the response.
Break it. Quite
got
the response,
some pillages
too. All the artillery. This is something you don't see a lot of human players do, actually. Sometimes you usually see tremors at this point to deal with a base like this. Not so much pillagers. They come up, but the hammers are normal. The pillagers are a little unusual. Tremors I would expect more often than not, but I agree with the pillager usage. That actually makes a lot of sense to me.
It's somewhat reactive.
Which is good. I mean, that is a lot of 0K is reacting to what you're... Or either reacting to or predicting what your opponents will build and then countering that. You need to have the economy to be able to do that, but knowing what to build is a huge part of the game. That is one of the biggest things that makes 0K 0K as opposed to most other Total Annihilation-based games, which tend to be more the numbers game. There's some counter structure, but 0K is more focused on the counter structure. Not to a fault, though, so if you haven't played it before, go for the economy first. That's still very important.
Oh, look around the left side. The AI is really sneaking in stuff there.
Yeah, another four glaives coming in over to the western side. JohnHunter's commander not quite seeing them. Do they know? Yeah, they know now. Lotus will be able to take out a couple.
Enough radar coverage.
Well, it's kind of funny because if you actually look at... Oh, yeah, not quite. No, that mountain barely has it covered, and the glaives are known, but just barely. So at this point, the glaives on top of the brawler. JohnHunter's base is pretty much dead. The brawler will be able to take care of the Lotuses. The glaives aren't going to do so hot. They're being quite careful about that, but those brawlers, that's going to finish the job. The shield factory is pretty much done. What is that binging? Is there a unit in the game that bings now?
Bings? Not that I know of.
Oh, weird.
I can't hear any binging.
You're hearing binging. Well, at any rate, this is certainly turning out to be a relatively even match. But the north side.
Yeah, look at John Hunter's lines of stingers. The AI is just sneaking things around. It's very good at going around things.
Yeah, that's a key thing in general. Like, I would say that this AI, so far what I've seen of it, it's got to be at least 1800 LO in terms of its overall skill. Like, if you were to rate it.
Oh, I don't know.
Player.
If you take it more seriously, you might. There's always foibles in AIs where you can just exploit something
right,
and they
Right, yeah.
Completely
I guess maybe 1650, 1700. That is the thing, of course. I mean, like with... Well, it's like with people, too, but the question is adaptability. And that's why I was wondering how adaptable the AI is, because if it is adaptable, then that would allow it to be more scary. Because with the human player, yeah, they'll often have weaknesses to foibles, but usually, after a while, they'll learn to deal with it. But at this point, JohnHunter's pretty much gone down, and Pink AI is moving on to, looks like, Manero. Gonna take
Look at the units
great.
Streaming in both sides, going right around that base in the middle.
Wow, that is tight. I mean, I'll admit the defensive line wasn't the strongest, but still, that is a very tight setup as far as all these units go and how they're going. Are they? They're just avoiding the sight ranges. Look in the middle, it looks like the units are just barely avoiding the sight ranges of the other units. I mean, they have radar. The north team has radar, so it can be seen. But if there was no radar, the units that the AI is sending through the middle would actually be invisible. It's being very careful about that. That is a nice little thing to program in there. A very clever move. Looks like at this point, Shaman and Alcur are just desperately trying to hold out on the eastern side of the map, on the northeast side of the map. But the economy difference is growing massively. The AI is, by default... Actually, no, maybe not. The AI is only like 5 metal above normally. The reclaim is the real killer. And Manero is mainly the one able to deal with the reclaim. Manero and, to a lesser extent, Alcur Shaman team. And actually, Alcur Shaman could really use a caretaker up here somewhere just to get all this reclaim going, because there's reclaims over here.
There's like, not much around, actually. Yeah, it's quite good at taking metal.
Manero is the only one that's... Now, even then, not much. Yeah, the AI has been just brutal about that. I feel like in economy, the AI is 1800 plus. Tactically, it seems like it's clever enough, and it has some really clever tricks. But I don't know if there's been enough units produced on either side to really say how it would work. I would expect at this point, if you're watching like 2000 LO players, that the game would be over by now, actually. But that would also be about twice as many units on both sides, which is curious.
Yeah, it seems quite good at sneaking in, but it's not so good at making clumped army, you know, clumped actual attacks. Like, you don't see a massive Reapers pushing in somewhere.
Yeah, that's exactly right. There's like a couple here or there. So very good for stealth attacks. I like that. I really appreciate that. Anyone who's watched me play, which I haven't played in a while, anyone who's played me would know that I love doing that sort of thing myself. Just sneaking in or getting around, just trying to find the weak points in other people's lines or in their bases in general, and trying to just exploit those. So I appreciate that a lot. But yeah, it is a very difficult thing to pull off, especially consistently, especially if you're not following up with larger conventional attacks once your opponent is either distracted or has been weakened down by your raiding. That being said, it does seem to be attacking in relatively coordinated numbers, especially over to the eastern side. It's not even focusing on the west anymore. In fact, the west seems like the beachhead for the northern team. A few spiders coming in here, trying to basically retaliate in kind, as far as I can tell. Although, a little bit one at a time.
It's got a jack. Killed a doomsday machine with a jack.
That doomsday machine wasn't fighting back, though. That was the weirdest thing.
Maybe it was unpowered. That makes sense.
Yeah, it wasn't powered, but it also didn't seem to have the heat ray either. I'm not sure if that
was... Yeah, the heat ray needs power now.
Oh, okay. I haven't messed around with the late-game artillery in a while. That explains it. I haven't really seen much late-game artillery recently. I didn't realize it got changed. Kind of makes sense, but... Yeah, a bit disappointing for the players, because if that doomsday machine had the heat ray, the jack would have been dead. No problems there.
Yeah.
At any rate, looks like the Alcur Shaman team getting a bit of pressure. Edrush coming to the rescue. Should be able to get rid of most of these units here. And with the disarm coming in, looks like there's a rack. Yeah, there's... Where's the racketeer? Oh, no, Thunderbird. Never mind. That's why. Yeah, so...
See, the Thunderbird's actually worse against the AI than people, because the units are so spread out and just... There's no clumps.
Yeah, that's... That is a difficulty indeed. It's a very weird style. It is very different. I guess it kind of makes sense when you consider the fact that the AI is theoretically infinite APM, but even then, it doesn't feel like it's really playing with that so much as just more built around trying to use... Actually, there's a tremor, so hey, previous comment. But it seems like it's more built around trying to just break things, like break into things and cut through the weaknesses, rather than...
It's just finding the weakest spot.
Yeah.
Consistently.
That does seem to be the thing, indeed. But the problem with that style is that if there aren't enough weak spots, or the weakest spot isn't that weak, it'll fall apart.
Yeah, definitely.
So I'd say that would be the thing to do if you wanted to beat Circuit, which is, that's probably its weakness. I'd be curious to see that tested, though, and especially since you mentioned it is more of a 1v1 AI. And in a team game, I'd say it's holding its own quite well. I mean, it is winning. And it's finding a lot of really good weak points, and there's enough weakness between the different players that didn't seem to coordinate their defenses between themselves as much. That the AI did have plenty of weaknesses to punch through. Like, pretty much walk in, or knock down a defender or two and then walk in.
Yeah, that is a thing with the North team was pretty static, at least at the start. There's a push on the left now, though.
Yeah, as mentioned before, the western side, that is the beachhead, that is pushing forward, that is actually managing to take some ground. It's a little risky, though. I mean, Tarantula Recluse is kind of useful. Definitely with a cloaking, it's handy, but having popped out of his cloak and with the Pillager on it, I mean, they're artillery range units, so essentially it's an artillery fight. But now the Rocko's coming into the side, and Rocko's are pretty much the counter to spiders, especially to Recluses. This is falling apart fast. There needs to be support forces. Hectorion needs someone coming in here with essentially air force, and they need a Thunderbird right here to want to be able to break through this. And at this point, they've lost.
Or Ravens. There were Ravens earlier.
Or Ravens, yeah. Something, some air support. But unfortunately, the air support player, Edrush, they are kind of distracted. Their air support is actually falling apart. It looks like their base is almost going to be crushed completely. The Alcur Shaman team losing their Cloakybot factory and the air factory. Wait, that's Alcur's airplane. Oh, wait, no, never mind. Edrush left. Edrush is gone, sent, left everything to Alcur and Shaman. So they are playing air support now, but now the air support's gone. The right side
is air support.
Completely.
It's on fire.
Well, okay, it was air support. Now it's. Yes, now it's just a forest fire waiting to happen. At any rate, with the eastern side fallen, I don't think the northern team has much of a shot at getting back at this. I mean, they have a shot, but the problem is they need to basically coordinate, take all this stuff, break, just close off the northwest side, reclaim as much as they can, and burst out within a couple minutes of reclaiming. That's pretty much the only shot they have. This western front over here, it's at least something. It's giving them some hope, some room. But unless they actually manage to take advantage of all the things they have, all the reclaim they have, which is quite a lot, but... Oh, even then, it's... Oh, it's actually fair bad.
There's sort of some room there.
Yeah, there's some room that's going back.
Right past it, going to the weaker areas.
But the AI is reclaiming it as well. Those welders need to go. They can't be allowed to stay there, and one of them already getting destroyed by a Doomsday Machine coming from Alcur. And it is powered this time. Unfortunately, it does not seem to be in range of these welders over here, which is a bit of a shame. This entire front area here is falling fast. And this one with only 35 metal in the bank, or 35 metal per second coming into the bank every second, North team is hard-pressed to hold this off. But hey, Scorpion, that might save the day. That Scorpion manages to...
Not against the massive area.
Well, no, it needs to push through and basically lock off a section, like help quarantine one section that can be then used to rebuild. But unfortunately, that's not being done, and the North team is very slowly falling and playing a lot more like a bunch of individual players than a team at this point, whereas the CircuitAI just seems like they're playing as a team. I can't even tell which one's which. Mostly because CircuitAIs tend not to be named. They have numbers, I guess.
There's 7, 4, 6?
Right. They have numbers.
There's 11 players.
Once again, I apologize for my horrible prejudice. I feel like Rocko's Basilisk will have a field day with me. Although at this point, what the heck just got blown to pieces? Oh. Scuttle coming in here to try to get rid of something. Oh, I see. It was CircuitAI 5 Scuttle coming in to try to get rid of the Scorpion here. So that middle section here, if that could be opened up, they could throw in some reclaim, throw in some workers to get that. I don't know how much worker power there is for the north, though. Like, reclaim is their only hope, and even now, that hope is so slim. Don't see what they have on hand. At this point, Manero is trying to... What are they even doing? They have nothing. Reclaimed as much as they can.
Their economy is just far too bad by this point.
Yeah, it's tanked, unfortunately. And it looks like the Northern team is going to be resigning, or at least half the team wants to resign.
The Doomsday Machine's barely done anything. It's just caused the AIs to go around. The one in the middle.
Yeah, well, most of the Middle Fortress entirely. That's been the entire purpose of the Middle Fortress in practice, has been the AI has simply avoided it. It's like a stone in a river. I mean, yeah, the water won't go through it, but it doesn't have to. So that does seem to be the thing to do with CircuitAI, is to put yourself in this position where the AI just has nowhere to punch through. Nowhere major, anyway. Like, the best they can do is still a bad idea. The problem with that, of course, is that it's difficult to do. It's kind of defensive, and being defensive in 0k is a good way to get yourself killed. But that was that. And it's like overall everything was in the metal income. Oh, there
yeah, have
teams.
A look at the graphs because
yeah, metal income was pretty close. Actually, North Team was ahead for a lot of it. Wow, it was neck and neck for most of the game.
Which is quite surprising, really, because you'd think an AI would just start losing, but no, the economy's really close.
Yeah, in unit value, however, the AI was always a little bit ahead. They might have lost
just shows more it's units. Efficient.
Yeah, they may have lost more units, but they also managed to kill more units as well. Just so happened to work out.
Well, that's absolute numbers. They built a lot more raiders and cheap units.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, the value, though, is quite telling.
Yeah, those Reapers just never really died. None of the heavy units ever really died. The Pillagers didn't really die. They went for a lot of safe options. Like, enough
and perhaps look at energy income.
Oh, North was way
North Team
ahead.
Really seemed to overbuild energy.
Yeah. And they didn't have a linked grid for a lot of the game either, I noticed. Like, they had a few small...
It's a low metal map, so that might be... one reason.
Yeah, if they had linked
the efficiency is really important when there's not much metal around.
Yeah, if they had linked that grid and used that to build more units, I think they would have had a much better chance. But it's a close thing, though. I mean, if you look at the amount of money spent on units, the amount of unit value at any given time, they were only off by about 10% maybe. It was not a huge difference until the last few minutes.
Well, the last third of the game. Yeah.
Well, yeah, last third of the game, but that was about 8 minutes. Which actually is an eternity in 0k, so what am I saying? But yeah, that was definitely a demonstration of what the AI can do. CircuitAI as well, which is, as you mentioned, and 1v1 optimized AI. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed...
Yeah, I thought it was quite impressive.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly enjoyed that. I hope you all enjoyed that watching there. And that is the AI. That is how the AI works. I hope you... If you're interested, you can go to 0k.info and download the game. Well, download the...
Oh, that's not how the AI works.
Well,
it's
true. The AI is a separate project. But that one... I'll throw some instructions to get AI. I don't believe it's part of the lobby. So
no, it's not. That one isn't in by default yet.
Yeah, so I'll throw some instructions into the description of the video. If you want to play around with the AI, which I believe this one uses a Java interface. Correct me if I'm wrong. So I think
I'm not sure, but I think Spring has a few AI interfaces, and they're all easy to use, as in you don't have to do anything. I have installed these AIs and played around with them, and you just put them somewhere, and Spring runs them.
Yeah.
So it's not hard.
Yeah, that's... That is a thing to keep in mind. So anyway, with that, I believe we are done. So thanks for joining me, GoogleFrog, as we go through the AI
yep,
and show off what it can do. Thank you all for watching. And like I said, if you enjoyed that, feel free to grab the game. It is free. And of course, you can also find the AI. The link will be in the description. And if you want to play human players, of course, there are human players as well. Human beings do play this game, even though in some cases...
Yeah, it's not just AI war.
But if you want to play AI, that's a challenge. We got that too. So, we got stuff. Anyway, thank you for watching and have a good night, everyone.